Over the past 20 or so years, China has made great strides regarding most air warfare platforms, including aircraft, airborne weapons technology, and anti-aircraft systems. But despite this, the US Air Force still reigns supreme as the world's most potent air combat arm. As a result, the Chinese are deathly afraid of the US Air Force for more than a couple of reasons. The first reason China is deathly afraid of the US Air Force is actually because they are currently outgunned and outnumbered. While this might seem like a shock when considering that China has about 4 times as many people and an economy comparable to the US, this is a result of both strategic decisions that China has made, which has hurt their overall air capabilities and have allowed the US to achieve both numerical and technological superiority. Over the past 20 or so years, China's made exponential gains in all types of military technology across every spectrum of warfare. However, the Chinese military also has to deal with budget constraints, much like their US counterparts. With a military budget typically about a third of what the US historically has had, they have to cut corners in many places. Unfortunately for the Chinese, they historically have cut a lot of corners with the Air Force, which has created this massive gap in both the number of combat aircraft and their capabilities. Regarding their raw numbers, the US Air Force alone has more aircraft than the entirety of China's Air Force, Army, and Naval Air Arms combined. As of the making of this video, the US Air Force by itself has just over 5,200 aircraft, with over 2,400 more on order to be delivered in the coming years. That starkly contrasts with the roughly 3,300 aircraft the entire Chinese military can bring to the fight today. But the US not only has a distinct numbers advantage, they also have far superior technology. For example, the gold standard of fighter technology for modern air battles is possessing fifth-generation fighters. Fifth-generation fighter definitions vary, but a broad definition would be a fighter aircraft that has advanced stealth technology that can defeat most, if not all, anti-aircraft radars, super cruise capabilities, secure and unbreakable communication suites, highly integrated computer and weapon systems, and strong airframes that are both flexible and light. The US Air Force fields 2 such aircraft. The first of these is the F-22 that came into service during the early 2000s. Though incredibly expensive, this competent and deadly aircraft is still considered by many to be the king of any modern dogfight. Its cousin, the F-35, finally reached full operational capability a few years ago, and the Air Force currently fields over 300 of these aircraft. Combined with just under 200 F-22s in service, the US Air Force has the world's largest fifth-generation fighter fleet by a mile that keeps growing yearly. By comparison, the Chinese Air Force equivalent fighter, the J-20, is still far behind the US capabilities. While US military officials have been pleasantly surprised at its maneuverability and the weapons packages that the Chinese have put on it, it's only somewhat comparable to the F-22 and does not come close to matching the F-35's capabilities. But fifth-generation fighters are not the only aircraft that would take to the skies in a peer-on-peer engagement. Fourth-generation fighters still make up the bulk of both the US and Chinese air fleets. While still outstanding aircraft, they often lack the stealth technology and more advanced avionics that fifth-generation fighters like the F-22 and the F-35 have. But even with slightly less capability than their fifth-generation or younger brothers, fourth-gen fighters like the F-15, F-16 still outclass their Chinese J-10, J-11, and J-16 counterparts. One of the primary reasons for this is their jet engines, or lack thereof. China has struggled to design and produce its own jet engines domestically. For decades, they've either bought, attempted to reverse engineer, or outright stolen plans for advanced engines. This is a big problem for China because of budget constraints that do not allow for research and development, and because their culture stifles critical thinking. Despite having a strong industrial base, China does not have an open economy that incentivizes development motivated by profit like in the US. As a result, China lacks the capability to design most of what they produce for both civilian and military markets. Take, for example, the simple ballpoint pen. You probably use one every day and think nothing of it. But while we in the US might take this writing implement for granted, making these was a huge hurdle for China. For years, China has made 80% of ballpoint pens in the world, but had to have all the ballpoint pens made overseas and shipped to China to assemble the final product. It was not until 2017, after much public pressure and government intervention, that China was able to produce its own domestic ballpoint pen. So if China has problems with even making a pen, they clearly have issues with making an aircraft engine capable of making their planes more powerful than their US equivalent. This is clearly shown by China's abysmal progress in designing, producing, and fielding their own jet engines. Since the late 70s, China's been attempting to reverse engineer American jet engines with little success. Instead, they relied heavily on countries like Russia to sell them jet engines. This is best evidenced when the Chinese agreed with Russia to produce several hundred Su-27 Flanker aircraft, because they had the best engines China could get their hands on at the time. After producing about 100 aircraft, the Chinese started making their own unlicensed copies that became the J-11. Because of this, Russia's been reluctant to sell China any more engines or aircraft. As a result, progress has remained slow for the past 20 years in building comparable jet engines for its fighters like the US possesses. It was not until the past few years that China's made progress in its first domestically produced engine. That was the WS-10. Despite being a great leap forward in jet engine technology, the WS-10 falls well below what US engineers are capable of, especially because of its lack of supercruising abilities. In aerial combat, having the ability to supercruise is a game changer. This means that the aircraft can travel faster than the speed of sound. Historically, this has been accomplished through the use of afterburners, but these have their downside. The main downside is that a pilot can only travel at greater than Mach 1 for limited amounts of time. With new engine technology like in the F-22, the US 5th generation fighters can travel at sustained supersonic speeds without the need for afterburners. Even China's most advanced fighter, the J-20, cannot do that. Additionally, though China's made several hundred of these engines, their performance has been mixed at best. While certainly good when they work, they're more often than not broken. And this is because the WS-10 reportedly needs maintenance up to 10 times more often than the US equivalent system. This means that the Chinese fighters equipped with this engine are out of the fight more often than their US counterparts. But a lack of progress in creating reliable jet engines has not only hurt future developments, but has also caused their fourth generation fighters to be at a disadvantage to fourth generation US counterparts. As a general rule, the J-10 and J-11, depending on the variant, are heavier and slightly larger than the F-15 and F-16. While differing doctrinal opinions, such as the Chinese Air Force being used mainly as a ground support force rather than an air dominance arm, has played a factor, the main differences have come from having to compensate for their inferior engines. Chinese and Russian engines are less fuel efficient than the ones the US churns out. As a result, Chinese aircraft need to carry more fuel if they want to increase their combat range or operate at higher speeds. The airframe also needs to be bigger to support all this extra weight, since China is also lagged behind in the metallurgic technology to make lighter, stronger airframes. The heavier aircraft and the more fuel it carries also limits the number of weapons these aircraft can carry, thereby hurting Chinese air power even more. As a result, despite great advances in Chinese avionics and weapons technology, both their 4th and 5th generation fighters remain outclassed by the US Air Force, who can travel further, move faster, and hit harder than what the Chinese could ever hope to do right now. China has been rapidly growing its air force to try to beat the US through raw numbers to compensate for inferior technology. As of the making of this video, China has about 1,300 fourth generation and 200 fifth generation fighters, a lot less than what the US fields. But while China's fourth generation efforts are rapidly catching up with the US's, as the air force fields more F-35s, this gap in technological capability will only widen unless China rapidly produces many more fighters and better engines. Another critical factor that would enable Chinese fighters to gain air superiority is their armament. Over the past decade, Chinese engineers have created some very potent weapons. The most prolific and deadly of these for US fighters has been the PL-15. Entering service almost 10 years ago, the PL-15 was a great leap forward in Chinese air-to-air missile technology. Not only is it incredibly fast, potentially seeing speeds of up to Mach 4 and having secure two-way data links between the firing unit, it also has an incredible range, with Chinese sources claiming that the missile has a range of up to 300 kilometers. While this range might seem a little out of the realm of possibility to many, the US Air Force took the threat seriously enough to start developing a new missile. Their primary long-range air-to-air missile, the AIM-120 Advanced Medium-Range Air-to-Air Missile, or AMRAAM, was suddenly outclassed. US planners immediately began to work on creating stopgaps in order to counter this threat that's been pressed into service while development continued on several new super-long-range missiles. The first of these missiles was the AIM-120D, and US engineers worked tirelessly to improve almost all aspects of the missile, including its motor, navigation system, communication suite, and jamming resistance. The end result was a missile that was just as fast as a PL-15, with about twice the range of traditional AIM-120 missiles, about 160 kilometers. The US also produced new versions of its short-range air-to-air missiles, the AIM-9X Sidewinder. While the missile has historically always been and still is a passive seeker, meaning it looks for things that emit infrared energy, the US designed it to be even more accurate. They did this by creating a new targeting system that's more accurate than previous variations. This is because the new AIM-9X can have a virtual library of infrared signatures to choose from and can lock on to smaller infrared signatures than before. Additionally, pilots can fire the missile without having to lock on first, which means the Air Force pilots can engage and disperse quickly to avoid counterfire from Chinese fighters. In addition to these fighter-launched weapons currently in service, the U.S. is developing newer air-to-air missiles that'll decimate Chinese fighters and bombers long before they reach their targets. Two of these missiles are the AIM-260 Joint Advanced Tactical Missile and Long-Range Engagement Weapon. While being independently developed by two American companies, both of these weapons are attempting to solve the same problem: how to reach out to the bad guy before he could reach out and touch American aircraft. With purported ranges of more than 200 kilometers and speeds up to Mach 5, these missiles would be faster and have a longer range than the primary Chinese air-to-air missiles. That means U.S. fighters can shoot down Chinese ones long before they could ever attempt to get a shot off at the Americans. But it's not just fighters that have extended-range weapons. The Air Force also has one that can reach out and destroy Chinese bases from much further distances, known as the AGM-158 Joint Air-to-Surface Standoff Missile, or JASSM. It's a marvel of airborne weapons technology that's been in the making for decades. During the Cold War, the Air Force and Navy wanted to develop their own cruise missile program. While the Navy's version eventually became the Tomahawk that's still in widespread use today, the Air Force had several other versions before tweaking the design to the current model introduced in 2014. The JASSM is an extremely long-range weapon that can be fired from most bombers and fighter aircraft. With a publicly admitted range of 1,900 kilometers for the newest variants, this range is likely even greater in reality. While it travels below the speed of sound, this extreme-range weapon allows American aircraft to fire on Chinese targets from a safe distance. In fact, with such extreme ranges, it allows the U.S. Air Force to basically strike Chinese ground targets without any fear of counterfire. This is because of China's antiquated air defense system that relies more on mass than sophistication. By the turn of the 21st century, Chinese air defenses were abysmal. Very few parts of the country had any coverage at all, and the parts that did have coverage was from just a small sample of outdated Soviet hand-me-downs. Because of this, wargaming then assessed U.S. aircraft would need just one fighter wing to penetrate most Chinese airspace, even with low degrees of stealth. However, China has certainly made great progress in this area since 2000 by blanketing most of the country with an intricate web of air defense radars, missiles, and artillery systems. The only problem is there are still Soviet hand-me-downs, just newer. The tip of the spear for China's air defense system is the legacy Soviet S-300 and its Chinese clone, the HQ-9. China has thousands of launchers, both from purchase and domestic manufacture, that they have put along the coast and interior to adequately protect most of its military installations. But there is just one problem. The S-300, despite being touted as such a mythical boogeyman in the media, is a very antiquated and poorly designed system. No matter what upgrades China makes to it, the S-300 has never been tested in combat, and its most critical test from 2006 proves just how bad it was. During this test, the Russian government wanted to see what the system could do. Over the course of several months, the Russian army fired 30 missiles at it, and the S-300 could not shoot a single one down. This is even though the missiles the S-300 had to shoot down were older ones that were slow and flew in a straight line. Even this was too much to handle for the Soviet system. While China has received several batteries of Russia's S-400 system, these are too few in number to make any meaningful impact. Additionally, the weapon system's efficacy is also disputed. Because of this, though, China does have very good depth for its air defense network. Because it's not very sophisticated at best, it would be able to let Chinese troops know they were about to be bombed by American aircraft with no ability to shoot them down. Part of the reason why China can't shoot U.S. aircraft down is because of America's huge advantage in stealth bombers. The U.S. currently has 20 B-2 stealth bombers in service compared to the zero China has, and probably will have at least for the next 10 years. The B-2 bomber is the pinnacle in U.S. aircraft technology. With its sleek design, composite materials, and other top-secret technologies, the aircraft can fly at a ceiling of 50,000 feet with a range of almost 7,000 nautical miles on one tank of gas. The plane is an absolute beast, and its combat record speaks for itself. Seeing combat in the Balkans, Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, and Libya, the plane is combat-tested and stands in a club of its own as the only true stealth bomber in operational service. But what makes China so scared of it is that no matter how much it increases its vast missile inventory ranges, it will never develop a missile system capable of striking the stealth bomber's home bases. That's because most of the time the aircraft is operated on the opposite side of the globe from where the target locations have been. For example, during wars in the Balkans and Iraq, most of the flights flew out of Missouri or the United Kingdom. Guam and Diego Garcia, an isolated island in the Indian Ocean, also routinely hosted combat operations. Despite just how awesome the B-2 is, the Air Force is also busy at work pumping out a new and improved stealth bomber called the B-21 Raider. After being in development for most of the past decade, the first fully functional model was unveiled just last year in 2022. While it might not look too different on the outside, the avionics and computer systems inside and the secret coatings on the aircraft have been improved so much that no current or projected air defense system can touch it. With a maiden flight planned for later in 2023, the Air Force intends to have about 100 of these bombers in service by the mid-2030s. So because of this, by the time China might start to conduct test flights on its own indigenous H-20 stealth bomber, the U.S. will have 100 bombers that are even better than the B-2. The strategic implications of this are huge and mean that the U.S. can cripple China's air defense network, command and control, and airfields without China being able to do anything about it. Along those same lines of not having stealth bombers, the U.S. Air Force possesses two unique capabilities China could only dream of having. The first of these is aerial refueling. Remember just a moment ago when we talked about how the B-2 could bomb targets all the way from Missouri? That was only possible because of aerial in-flight refueling. This evolution, much like the Navy's underway replenishment, while seemingly mundane and boring, is a tactical skill that actually has strategic-level impacts. For decades, the Air Force has been the premier fighting force in the art of aerial refueling. Every type of aircraft can do it. Fighters, bombers, cargo planes, and everything in between conducts this maneuver on a routine basis. The stars of these evolutions are the KC-135 Stratotankers and the KC-10 Extender. The newest model, the KC-46 Pegasus, also carries out this mission as it comes online and replaces aging aircraft that face retirement. Because of this, the U.S. is almost 90% of the entire world's tanker inventory. While seemingly mundane, it has a huge impact. The most obvious impact is that this capability extends the range of every type of U.S. aircraft. This has second and third order effects, such as keeping air bases out of harm's way and allowing aircraft more time on target. On the other hand, China currently has just a few dozen tankers in its inventory, compared to over 500 the U.S. possesses, and most of these are old Soviet planes. China said they're going to develop a bigger, better tanker fleet, but this is unlikely. Because of this, most Chinese pilots cannot even perform aerial refueling. This means that they're tied to the operational limits of their aircraft and need bases to refuel them. This lack of capability forces Chinese pilots to return to base sooner and travel a lesser distance than their U.S. counterparts. Additionally, because Chinese pilots cannot aerial refuel anywhere near the capacity U.S. forces can, it means that taking out their air bases from either stealth bombers or standoff weapons would have a huge impact on their operational capability. If Chinese planes cannot refuel close enough to a fight, the Chinese military would lose air superiority, simply because the planes would run out of gas before getting into action. And unfortunately for China, they would need all the fighter support they could get in the war with the US because of another asset that would be completely dominating the battlefield, the A-10 Thunderbolt, also affectionately known as the Warthog. The A-10 Thunderbolt is undoubtedly the best ground attack aircraft in service today and arguably of all time. There's a good reason why the plane has been in service for almost 50 years and will continue to be used for the next several decades to come. Its combat record speaks for itself, having first seen combat in the Gulf War. The A-10 has been a mainstay of the American military operations for 30 years. With thousands of destroyed tanks, armored vehicles, and artillery systems under its belt, the A-10 is the most combat-proven close air support aircraft in the skies today. While there has been talking throughout the years to retire the aircraft, its performance has been too good to do so, and the U.S. has opted to re-wing the remaining fleet to keep them airworthy. While it might be true that the A-10 does not have the best onboard countermeasures and defense systems in a highly contested environment, the critics of the plane would need to understand that these aircraft would not be sent in alone and certainly without preparing the battle space through suppression of enemy air defense first. Because of the likely scenario of Chinese air bases being destroyed early in a conflict with the U.S., the Chinese would most likely lose the capability to keep constant air cover for its forces. Combined with the destruction of their air defenses by superior aircraft, this would make for a ripe hunting ground for the Warthog, allowing the aircraft to decimate Chinese ground forces. Now watch, could Taiwan hold off a Chinese invasion? Or check out why China will never be a global superpower.